for 150 more here in South Carolina on yesterday. And the day before, Wednesday, marked our largest single day increase of COVID-19 deaths. Local community leaders across the country, Democrats and Republicans, need strong federal leadership to help them combat this deadly threat. Communities need federal help to get the protective equipment and testing supplies they need to protect their frontline medical workers and essential employees. Unfortunately, the administration is leaving it up to the states, forcing them to compete against each other in order to purchase equipment and supplies from the private sector, leading to higher prices and greater shortages. We need the federal government to use its existing authorities to efficiently, effectively, and equitably get resources to the states and cities that need them most. This committee has heard from bipartisan public health experts that cities and states need a comprehensive nationwide plan to safely reopen the economy, including detailed plans for testing, contact tracing, and containment. Instead, states have been forced to develop their own testing plans, leading to inefficient, ineffective, and inequitable patchworks that will only prolong and exacerbate the crisis. Local governments are also facing financial crises. A recent survey shows that 9 in 10 cities expect budget shortfalls due to the coronavirus outbreak, and many will be forced to lay off employees and cut critical services, including first responders and the emergency services they provide. These cities need emergency federal relief now to prevent a collapse of their economies and public functions. To prevent these harmful outcomes, the House passed the HEROES Act, which provides hundreds of billions of dollars in relief to small and mid-sized communities. I encourage the Senate to send that bill to the President's desk for his signature without further delay. A plethora of local leaders across the country have shown real leadership during this pandemic. Some of them are here with us today, mayors who are guiding their cities through this public health crisis with resolve and integrity. Big City Mayor Eric Garcetti of Los Angeles, who was one of the first mayors in the country to close non-essential businesses and issue a mandatory safer at home emergency order, potentially saving thousands of lives and other illnesses. Small town mayor Mary Jane Scott of Mangrum, Ohio, who has led her city through a virus outbreak that spread through a local nursing home with tragic consequences. These and the other local leaders who are with us today are on the front lines of the coronavirus pandemic. They have the difficult, challenging job of protecting the health of their residents while also trying to safely reopen their economies and keep their city services running. The goal of today's briefing is to find out how they think the federal government can provide the resources they need to protect their citizens and the guidance they need to sustain critical services and reopen economic activity. This is not about casting blame. It's about repairing faults, protecting communities, and saving lives. I hope we can listen and learn from these local leaders in an open and bipartisan way. I now recognize Ranking Member Scalise for his opening remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I join you in welcoming all of our guests, the mayors of all of these great cities. Appreciate the work that you do every day on the front lines. Mr. Chairman, as you said, our country mourns a grim and somber milestone. The virus has taken the lives of over 100,000 of our fellow Americans. The speed at which this evil, invisible virus has killed has been unmatched by any foreign military foe in our nation's history. Every American family has been touched in some way by this virus and the global response that has brought us here today. We've seen tragedy, we've seen hardship, but we've also been reminded again of what a truly united and compassionate country America is. From the frontline healthcare workers to every individual who social distances to protect others, we've come together to flatten the curve. Let us not forget the strength and resolve of this great nation. But the focus of today's hearing points to another hard-earned lesson. America needs to safely get back to work. Our health depends on it. The ability of mayors to govern, to fix the streets, to have the money to pay police, firefighters, teachers, our ambulance drivers. It all depends on America safely getting back open again, our upward mobility, and the promise that no matter where you begin, you can achieve your dreams in America. That depends on America reopening and that opportunity for all who seek it. Our personal relationships with our family, friends, with God, all depends on us getting back to a free and mobile life. Some have said we must remain closed or prepared to be closed again, as if it were some trade-off between health and jobs. Mr. Chairman, our physical and mental health depends on safely reopening, on reestablishing our quality of life. A new Kaiser poll released this week shows 48% of Americans have delayed medical care due to this pandemic. 11% said their personal condition worsened as a result of that delayed care. The same poll shows nearly 40% of Americans said stress related to the coronavirus has negatively affected their mental health. Compared with last April, texts to federal government mental health hotlines are up roughly 1,000%. And we know that people with lower incomes and those whose jobs or wages have been cut are experiencing the highest levels of psychological distress. A new survey by the American Cancer Society found that among cancer patients in active treatment, 79% reported care delays, including 17% who reported delays to cancer therapy like chemotherapy, radiation, or hormone therapy. One study predicts that if the United States reaches depression-era level unemployment rates, we could see 18,000 additional suicides and 22,000 more overdose deaths. More than half of childhood vaccinations are not being performed, setting up the potential for a massive future health disaster, including a measles outbreak, which is being predicted. Is anyone still wondering whether remaining closed is bad for our nation's health? Just think about those devastating numbers. The healthcare industry has not been left out of this as well. They've lost over 1.4 million jobs in April. Imagine that, over a million people who are working to improve the health of America are no longer able to be doing their jobs. 38 million Americans have filed unemployment claims since late March, but even that unthinkable number does not tell the whole story. The burden of this shutdown has disproportionately fallen on those in our society least able to bear it. The Federal Reserve Chairman said that 40% of Americans earning less than $40,000 a year have lost their job since the economy was shut down. 80% of jobs recently lost were those with below average weekly wages. 6 in 10 Hispanic adults say they or someone in their household has lost a job or taken a pay cut due to the coronavirus outbreak. We all agree and understand that unemployment leads to an increase in deaths. Based on all these facts, if we don't see a more concerted effort by some to safely reopen, we may lose more Americans to the shutdown than we have to the virus itself. We cannot let that happen. We can safely reopen, and we must safely reopen. In fact, many states and cities have already shown us how to effectively do this. Our witnesses today are mayors, officials who have seen firsthand the impact of the shutdown. They've seen their healthcare system stressed, but not overrun. They're starting to see local businesses reopen, but they're also seeing some of their businesses disappear. Children left with fewer educational opportunities. Every one of these mayors, you all know that this cannot go on. No relief package we pass can substitute for a fully functioning economy. And all that goes with an open and free society. I look forward to hearing the details on each witness's plan to safely reopen, what each of you has learned, and how each city plans to adapt as new information from across the country on what is working becomes more widely available. And hopefully we can share in a better way the best learned practices for those communities who are doing it well, so that those who aren't as far along can learn those best practices as well and safely reopen their economy too, and hopefully prevent more deaths from occurring, both from COVID-19 and from the devastating impacts of the shut-in related to COVID-19. With that, Mr. Chairman, I look forward to hearing from the witnesses, and I yield back.
Thank you very much, Ranking Member Scalise. And now we will hear from our panelists, and let me once again welcome them. We are pleased to be joined today by mayors from all across our country, leaders of communities large and small, urban, suburban, and rural. Our first panelist is Mayor Jenny Durkin from Seattle, Washington. Mayor Durkin led Seattle through the first U.S. outbreak of coronavirus and was among the first leaders to encounter many of the shortcomings of the federal response. Mayor Durkin has provided perspective and leadership to her fellow mayors as they also confront the spread of the virus. Next, we will hear from Mayor Stephen K. Benjamin of Columbia, South Carolina, my mayor. Mayor Benjamin is past president of the United States Conference of Mayors and has been a strong advocate for reopening the city of Columbia based on data and science. He has also provided leadership in supporting local businesses, seniors, and homeless populations throughout the pandemic. We'll also hear from Mayor Brian K. Barnett from Rochester Hills, Michigan. Mayor Barnett is the current president of the U.S. Conference of Mayors, and he has been a fierce advocate for cities and towns across the country that are seeking flexible and direct federal aid to support essential services during this pandemic. Next, we'll hear from Mayor Keisha Lance Bottoms from Atlanta, Georgia. Mayor Bottoms took early action to issue a stay-at-home order to save lives in Atlanta. She has taken a science-based approach to reopening and has drawn national attention to the disproportionate impact of the coronavirus on communities of color. Then we will hear from Mayor Mary Jane Scott of Mangum, Ohio, who I introduced earlier. After Mayor Scott, we will hear from Mayor Lenny Curry of Jacksonville, Florida. Mayor Curry has been increasingly testing and losing testing as a key focus of his reopening strategy in Jacksonville, Florida. Finally, we will hear from Mayor Eric Garcetti of Los Angeles, who I also introduced earlier. I thank all of our distinguished panelists for joining us today, and I now recognize Mayor Durkin for her opening remarks.
Thank you, Chairman Clyburn, Ranking Member Scalise, and members of the Select Committee. My testimony today has been forged by nearly 3 months of harsh truths from fighting the devastating consequences of COVID-19 at the original epicenter of this crisis. Before I share my prepared remarks, I want to first acknowledge what is happening in Minneapolis and express my sincere condolences to the loved ones of George Floyd. Like the disparate impacts of COVID-19, this shows the stark reality of structural racism in our country. We must continue to work to dismantle its insidious impacts. Prior to the pandemic, we were one of the fastest growing cities in the country and had a booming economy. All of that changed 3 months ago today when COVID-19 struck unexpectedly. The well-documented federal testing failures hid the spread in our community. Our local scientists and health officials raised alarm bells, urging us to act quickly. We did, faster than nearly any city and region in the country. Mayors and governors had to write our own pandemic playbook. The people of our region showed they are unmatched in their strength, caring, and willingness to act for the common good. By acting together, we have helped flatten the curve and save thousands of lives. Today, Seattle has some of the lowest number of cases among major cities, but this has been achieved with devastating economic consequences. We work quickly to help residents stay afloat, from halting evictions, to relief grants for small businesses, to creating a food voucher program for families, and now making sure CARES Act money gets to the people who really need it. But Seattleites, like so many Americans, are weary, and their suffering is real. As Congress considers its next actions, please remember America has the innovative power, the ingenuity, and the strength to match and beat this virus. This unprecedented crisis has taken more American lives than 10 years of the Vietnam War. It has destroyed jobs and businesses and has laid bare the deep inequities in our society. To win this fight, I ask Congress and this administration to act in 5 key areas. First, use the Defense Production Act to aggressively produce and distribute testing kits, PPE, face coverings, and other critical supplies. Mayor Garcetti and I shouldn't be bidding against each other, driving up costs and risking lives. End the scavenger hunt Hunger Games process, especially as we try to reopen and prepare for the next wave of the virus. Second, Congress should invest in America through a bold 21st century New Deal that is a fair deal that creates jobs and tips the scales back to working Americans. Expanded unemployment is critical, but we need a bold vision for jobs if we want to fix the economic and health chasms exposed by this virus, particularly for communities of color. We need to guarantee health care for all. We could create millions of new jobs by investing in urgent infrastructure needs, green technology and transportation, internet accessibility for all, and affordable housing. Third, Congress should help address the unforgivable crisis in our nation's senior facilities. Nearly 70% of the deaths in our region from COVID-19 have been in senior living facilities. Our country's nursing homes should not be a death sentence. America owes our elders better than that. Fourth, the federal government needs to lead on data standards and strategies for the disease, reopening, and contact tracing. 50 states with 50 different battle plans will cause more death. Decisions and metrics should be transparent, equitable, and based on real science and guidance. Finally, cities need sustained, significant, direct relief. Cities are home to a majority of America. We are innovators and the safety net. We are your front line in this battle and critical to success. In addition to the critical services we provide to our first responders, we're providing meals, childcare for essential workers, expanded services for seniors and individuals experiencing homelessness, testing for our residents, and emergency relief for businesses and workers. We are still in the early days of this generational challenge. Defeating this virus requires a unified, generational response. In these last months, we have seen so many acts of hope, sacrifice, resolve, and courage. I'm asking you to match that resolve and courage. Invest in a better America. Thank you again for the opportunity to speak with you here today.
Thank you very much, Madam Mayor. We now recognize Mayor Stephen Benjamin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We agree and support Mayor Durkin's prayer for Minneapolis, for the Floyd family, for justice, peace, and for this great country in which we live. Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Scalise, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for this opportunity to provide insight into the needs that our cities currently have to safely reopen and brief you on how COVID-19 has impacted Columbia and how the federal government can further help us address this public health emergency and the related economic and fiscal crises. My name is Steve Benjamin. I serve as my third term as mayor of Columbia, South Carolina, a thriving and diverse city that's home to more than 134,000 people. In addition to being the capital of our state, we host nearly 50,000 students attending our several universities and colleges. We're also the proud home of Fort Jackson, the Army's largest training base in the world. Off the top, let me start by thanking you for all that you and your colleagues are doing to address these crises. I want to make it clear that I deeply appreciate all that Congress has done. You have acted quickly and decisively at levels commensurate with the severity of these crises. That said, and even in light of all that you have done, we must all do more. Congress must act decisively to provide the necessary funding and support for our nation's cities and to make sure that our country emerges from these crises stronger than ever. As has been well documented, I and almost every other mayor in the nation are clear and adamant that the next bill must include direct and targeted flexible fiscal assistance to cities, including funding for all cities that are CDBG entitlement cities. I'm pleased that the HEROES Act approved by the House would appropriate $375 billion of fiscal assistance to units of local government. This funding is critical. Almost every state and local budget forecast predicts a revenue gap for this year and next year. In 2019, state and local governments tax revenue totaled about $2.4 trillion. A 10% reduction in revenue, an optimistic forecast, therefore totals $240 billion. Simply put, absent flexible federal fiscal assistance, state and local governments will be forced to lay off employees, cut services, and take other measures that undermine any counter-cyclical fiscal and monetary actions taken at the federal level. In Columbia, we predict a more than $20 million revenue loss for next year's fiscal budget. Cities are facing major public health and major public safety challenges. At the same time, we are facing an unprecedented fiscal crisis. Demand and need for core local government services have increased significantly. At the same time, we're all projecting unprecedented levels of revenue loss. Cities need real money, direct, flexible, and targeted assistance, such as the $375 billion, including the HEROES Act, to ensure that we can continue to address this crisis and provide basic services. In recent weeks, we have heard some disturbing and unsubstantiated arguments from some of your colleagues, I must say, against providing direct fiscal assistance to local governments to help us address the public health, economic, and fiscal crises arising from COVID-19. I appreciate this opportunity to point out that Columbia, like all local governments, are required by law to balance our budgets. We're proud that not only have we done that, we've ended most years, 8 of the last 10 with a budget surplus, all without raising taxes while improving core local services. The City of Columbia, like many cities throughout the country, delivers core local services to your constituents, our mutual constituents, that are the foundation of our economy. We do it well and efficiently. Another topic of importance to Columbia and cities are, of course, municipal bonds. Municipal bonds are the bread and butter of infrastructure investment. Unfortunately, the crisis has frozen the bond market and driven up borrowing costs. We appreciate the Federal Reserve's plans to use some Section 13.3 emergency loan authority to purchase $500 billion in short-term municipal securities issued by states and large cities and counties. However, the 250,000 population cutoff leaves every city in South Carolina and most in the South out in the cold. We'd urge Congress to provide the Federal Reserve with additional authority to maintain our nation's core infrastructure investment tool beyond this crisis. Absent such action, I fear that this crisis will still do significant damage to the municipal bond market. As a reminder, state and local governments account for 75% of our nation's infrastructure investment. Most of those investments financed are municipal bonds. Legislation such as Senator Menendez's Municipal Bond Emergency Relief Act would be a good start. I also can't overstate how proud and appreciative we are of Columbia's frontline workers. Simply put, they are truly heroes. Let me be clear when I say that we appreciate their services, and symbolic gestures are not enough for people risking their health and safety to provide us with essential services. We need to make sure our frontline essential workers are taken care of. And that's why we're pleased the HEROES Act passed by the House includes several provisions that would just do just that. In closing, I appreciate your leadership. We're fully supportive of additional assistance as well to small businesses to make sure they can survive this pandemic. Columbia launched a very successful small business assistance program that has helped hundreds of small businesses unable to tap into PPP. We're also pleased that the CARES Act and its successor includes funding for CDBG, homeless assistance grants, and nutrition programs will provide a lifeline to many of our most vulnerable residents, as well as testing that will be critical to reopening the economy. Thank you for your work in highlighting the needs of cities to reopen safely during this pandemic, for your work in the subcommittee, and for this opportunity to share Columbia's response to date and our priorities for a future relief bill. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mayor Benjamin. And next, we'll hear from Mayor Barnett. Mayor Barnett, you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Good afternoon, Chairman Clyburn, Ranking Member Scalise, and members of the Select Subcommittee. Thank you for inviting me to speak today as well. I do want to echo my colleagues' comments in saying that we do mourn for the loss of George Floyd and grieve for the loved ones he left behind and pray for peace and justice for all in every city. Mayor Frey is a friend. We have reached out to him. He's an important part of our conference. And we'll continue to pray for his leadership. As mayor of Rochester Hills, Michigan, a beautiful town of 75,000 people in suburban Metro Detroit, and quite an honor to serve as president of the United States Conference of Mayors, it's my honor to discuss the ongoing needs of America's mayors as we work to reopen our cities, protect the health and well-being of our residents, and stabilize our local economies. I want to start by thanking you and the administration for providing our citizens, hospitals, small businesses, and so many others with the critically needed resources and tools to fight this pandemic. There's no question that what you've done and these resources have helped save lives and hopefully forestalled an even deeper national economic recession. That said, my message today is straightforward and urgent. American cities are still being devastated by this pandemic, and it is imperative that Congress and the administration take swift and aggressive action before the start of the next fiscal year, which for many cities begins on July 1st. Mayors everywhere are leading the local efforts to defeat the virus, and yet most cities, like mine, have been left behind in Washington's response when it comes to direct fiscal assistance. And even the 38 larger cities, some of them represented on this Zoom call, with populations over 500,000, can't use that money to mitigate budget shortfalls. You know, the Conference of Mayors, hopefully you all know who we are. We're a proud organization with an 88-year history, a bipartisan organization that more than that is nonpartisan. My colleagues and friends testifying with me today, don't let political affiliations get in the way of tackling problems. And we're exceptionally proud of that reputation. And as you know, and I can tell you that there is no political affiliation or geographic boundary that defines which cities have been affected and need relief from Washington. Not a blue city or a red city issue, and there's no part of America or within your home districts that have not been significantly impacted by this pandemic. And just as this virus is striking everywhere, the economic collapse is being felt everywhere, local resources are being decimated everywhere. According to a report from the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities, in just 1 month, states and localities furloughed or laid off close to 1 million workers, more than the 750,000 in the entire aftermath of the Great Recession of a decade ago, just in 1 month. And to further illustrate the real need for support for all cities, our conference, the U.S. Conference of Mayors, launched a pretty neat tool called the Mayor's COVID-19 Fiscal Pain Tracker on usmayors.org. And this is a resource that provides accounts from individual cities of the significant revenue losses cities are experiencing and the actions they've had to take to balance their budgets, which, of course, as you know, is required by law. The tracker now provides information from over 170 cities and really shows us a nasty narrative of revenue shortfalls and increased expenses, truly a perfect storm. Now, in my city, we've seen layoffs and furloughs and revenue reductions. And the revenue reductions come from shortfalls in funding received from our state, a reduction in the fees that we receive from city services, and a sharp reduction, of course, from investment income. Now, our funding from services, city services, include fees for permits, building inspections, park fees, all of those came to an abrupt and unexpected halt. One quick example that I'm sure is probably true in every city in your district, it's a small one, but I think it's important. Youth soccer, for example, didn't take place in the spring in my community. And that one cancellation of one league and a soccer field rental fee resulted in $200,000 of lost revenue, revenues that can't be made up. These three areas combined represent sources that support over one third of my city's budget. And at the same time, we're fronting incremental COVID-related expenses, of course, PPE, but also enhancements to our ventilation systems, retrofitting our buildings to provide a safe environment for employees, residents, and business partners. Now, we understand that Washington's whole of America response to this pandemic is to be federally supported and locally executed, and we couldn't agree more. And we feel like we're executing locally. When a COVID call comes in to Rochester Hills, it's responded to by a Rochester Hills firefighter riding in a Rochester Hills ambulance on a Rochester Hills road, ending up at a Rochester Hills hospital. Washington's not involved in any part of that, but we do need you and your support to make it sustainable. Additionally, mayors want to reopen our cities as quickly as possible, but we know there's no magic formula that will tell us when it's safe to reopen. As mayors, we each know our cities best, so local readiness and flexibility will be key to the gradual reopening. For our local businesses to successfully reopen, they'll need liquidity, time, employees who are ready to work, and confidence. We appreciate the federally supported and locally executed approach because the road to recovery runs straight through America's cities, the same cities that are leading the pandemic response on the ground. But without federal support, cities will likely become a drag on the very economic recovery that they would otherwise be leading. What we're experiencing across our country is not a big city problem, it's an every city problem. And while we appear to be getting closer, we need action, and the action is urgent. The mayors on this call and mayors across the country stand ready to work with each and every one of you. I thank you for allowing me the time to participate in this important discussion.
Thank you very much, Mayor Barnett. We now recognize Mayor Bottoms for 5 minutes.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm Keisha Lance Bottoms, mayor of Atlanta, Georgia, the cradle of the civil rights movement and the 10th largest economy in the United States. Thank you to Chairman Clyburn and to each of you for inviting me to testify today. Let me begin by also offering my sincerest condolences to the Floyd family and to Representative Waters on the passing of her sister. Across America, our communities are sick and tired and now dying. That's why the city of Atlanta is in the process of a thoughtful and strategic reopening that's driven by data, metrics, and the advice of leading medical experts such as Dr. Carlos Del Rio of Emory University School of Medicine and the Rollins School of Public Health at Emory and a member of the National Academy of Medicine. As we begin to reopen, we're focusing on the safety and health of our residents and businesses by following the recommendations of our own advisory council for the reopening of Atlanta. This group consists of 60 businesses, academic, medical, faith-based, and philanthropic leaders who have provided us with a science-based roadmap for reopening our city. We listened to our residents through a recent survey, which prompted nearly 16,000 responses, indicating in overwhelming fashion that Atlantans felt unwilling to go to most businesses and venue types. The majority indicated that they did not feel safe going to establishments without taking their own protective measures, and they would be willing to wear a face mask if required to do so by a workplace or a business establishment. Atlanta is the most densely populated city in Georgia, and especially vulnerable to COVID-19. We're home to many residents with underlying health conditions such as diabetes, heart disease, and cancer. In fact, all four of my children suffer from asthma. We have a large population of African Americans who experience greater COVID-19 disparities than other populations. A recent CDC report showed that more than 80% of those hospitalized by COVID-19 in Georgia were in fact African American. Across America, the COVID-19 pandemic has underscored racial health and economic inequities that deserve an urgent and larger national conversation. As our native son, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. reminded us, of all the forms of inequality, injustice in healthcare is the most shocking and inhumane. Atlanta also faces the challenge of being located in one of the first states to reopen non-essential businesses, even as COVID-19 hotspots continue to develop. That's why we're closely watching our numbers and monitoring the impact of our state's reopening on COVID-19 cases by monitoring our hospital bed and ICU capacity to make sure we are not overwhelmed, because we simply are not out of the woods yet. We must address the public health crisis in order to return to a healthy economy, and we are encouraged by the progress we are making, some of which we can credit to action we took at the onset of this outbreak. From the start, my motto to our team has been, God bless the child who's got his own. We quickly allocated $7 million from our budget to expand food programs for seniors and children, providing assistance to small businesses. We stood up shelters for the homeless and helped residents in need of housing assistance. We suspended the termination of water bill payments, and we were one of the first cities to institute hazard pay for our sanitation workers and essential employees well before we knew it would be covered under the CARES Act. And we placed a moratorium on evictions of city-sponsored properties. We launched a local initiative, ATL Strong, to raise donations to support our residents and small businesses, like our cosmetologists and barbers who are receiving $1,000 grants through our Strength and Beauty Fund. We'll continue to advocate for and we'll continue to provide support for all of our residents who are struggling financially. But cities can only do so much. As a result of this pandemic, we're facing a revenue shortfall of nearly $35 to $40 million in this year's budget, and have placed a much needed $100 million affordable housing bond on indefinite hold. While we've not yet furloughed employees, we have not missed a beat related to public safety and providing other essential functions. We are squeezing every single dime. We're grateful for the nearly $89 million we received directly to the city of Atlanta, and the $338 million received by Hartsfield-Jackson Atlanta International Airport under the CARES Act, and also respectfully ask for the passage and signing of the HEROES Act to provide more equitable relief to all Americans. These are unprecedented times, and we need to make bold investments in our working families. We need additional support to bolster small businesses and people who are working paycheck to paycheck at jobs that are endangered and have been placed on hold. It does not matter if you are located in a blue state or a red state. We are all in a state of emergency as it relates to COVID-19, and we appreciate the relief that has been given and will be given to provide help and assistance for the people of Atlanta and all who call America home. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mayor Bottoms. We now recognize Mayor Scott for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. It's amazing. I'm a little intimidated, but I'm going by it real strong. First of all, Mangum is in Oklahoma. We are in Southwest Oklahoma, and we are only about 2,700 residents in Greer County here. About 30% or more of our residents are 65 years or older, so we have a vulnerable population. We were hit hard when the pandemic hit, when over half the population in our nursing home was infected with the virus, and then, of course, several of the employees were infected also. And we became the highest infected community per capita in the state of Oklahoma at 10.9%. which is not something we really want to do. The city immediately declared an emergency, and the citizens, as always, were very cooperative, and we put forth the effort. And at the present time, we are in the process of going through the steps with the Governor Stitt's phases to open. But now we have a great financial concern. I have visited with farmers, ranchers, business owners, and regular citizens in rural Southwest Oklahoma regarding how this has affected them. The ranchers are concerned about the sale of their cattle and the trade deals the U.S. has with other countries. Small businesses are struggling, and even if a business, just one business, fails, it's devastating consequences in our little city. The job loss is our big concern, that the jobs won't be there whenever the pandemic is over. Rural communities need better technology. I heard this from someone else. When our schools were shut down, the rural communities or the rural people that lived out in the country did not have adequate Wi-Fi to do their public school assignments and the college classes online because we do not have good enough technology out in the country. Since 2010, there have been 120 rural hospitals that have closed across the United States, and Oklahoma was one of the worst in losing seven hospitals in rural hospitals in 2019. We now are faced with 1.5 million rural Oklahomans with significantly decreased access to health care. The COVID tests are free here in Greer County, but it takes 3 to 5 days for those results, and this is not good. We are sending our tests to Tennessee because we don't have labs to test. In the heart of Mangum, we have an 18-bed critical access hospital established in 1967, and they serve six counties with 24-hour emergency services. And as the hospitals across the country have felt the heavy economic hit, we are fighting to keep our great hospital open. I believe the federal government must give us some kind of support for our rural hospitals. This support needs to be free of stipulations from the funds that they have to be used for COVID-19 related expenses. In addition, possibly, maybe have a plan for rural areas to have a designated hospital so the small hospitals are not completely and totally overburdened. The last thing I would like to say is that the city of Mangum was the first in the state to purchase rapid test kits, and we test our employees each week. This was necessary because we don't have the human resources with the loss of, say, two of our police officers that had to go quarantine out of only five in our entire town, and then other essential workers that we have. We have two sources of income here, sales tax and the sale of our electricity. And we're looking at 75% to 80% of our tax revenue to decline for April and May. That is huge to us. We struggle through this right now, but if there is another wave this fall, it will be devastating to our city's ability to provide the needed services to our community. Police, fire, parks, city pool, libraries will all need help to survive. We will need federal assistance of some kind. Once again, thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak on behalf of my community.
Thank you very much, Mayor Scott. We now recognize Mayor Curry for 5 minutes. Mayor Curry.
Thank you, Chairman. First, let me, from Jacksonville, send prayers for peace and justice to Minneapolis, and prayers for justice through every community across our nation. Thank you, Chairman Clyburn, Ranking Member Scalise, and subcommittee members for this opportunity. This is my fifth year as mayor of Jacksonville, Florida, the most populous city in the state and the 12th largest in the nation. The people of Jacksonville are kind, generous, and resilient. They've risen up to face this crisis in ways that are both wise and compassionate, and I'm incredibly proud to serve as their mayor. On the topic of this hearing, and given the fact that Jacksonville has been well served by the federal response from President Trump in Congress, let me say thank you on behalf of my city to all of you. President Trump and Governor DeSantis have provided the foundation that our local response has been built upon. Together, as we saw this virus coming, we took actions immediately to flatten the curve and protect our health systems. We prevented dire situations like we saw elsewhere, with doctors forced to make impossible decisions about who can live and die due to shortages of life-saving equipment. In Jacksonville, we never exceeded the capacity of our local healthcare facilities to respond. Governor DeSantis and our city's emergency teams created rapid responses to senior assisted living facilities to prevent hotspots from seeing the terrible outcomes reported in other parts of the nation. As a result, since the first week of April, we have seen steady declines in the percentages of positive COVID-19 tests. With a flattened curve in Jacksonville, and with the advice of healthcare experts, we've begun a pathway back to work and toward a new normal. While the medical community is working hard and there are promising leads, the fact is we may not have a vaccine for quite some time. But we cannot quarantine and shut down the nation's economy indefinitely. Doing so puts too great a burden, financial and otherwise, on our neighbors and our families. It would, in fact, be a cure worse than the disease. An example of the quarantine's unintended impact on my city is seen in opioid overdoses. Since we declared a state of emergency on March 13, our overdose 911 calls have outpaced the 2019 numbers significantly every single week. But that's not the only area where we're seeing the impacts of the national shutdown. Many have lost jobs and income due to COVID-19. Small businesses have struggled to stay open, and some have had to close. People are struggling with depression and other mental health issues. Many more are anxious to know how they'll keep their homes, pay their bills, and just simply put food on the table. We've taken major steps to help those affected in our city. We've promoted access to financial relief, mental health services, and business resources. We set up a small business loan and grant program so businesses could keep employees on the payroll, and it's worked. We started a mortgage, rent, and utility relief program, providing $1,000 in direct assistance to 45,000 Jacksonville households using the CARES Act funding. These programs, along with safe, smart, incremental reopening of our city and economy, have lessened the impact as compared to other regional metropolitan areas. But our people are still hurting. Personal responsibility plays a big role in the move forward. In Jacksonville, I encourage citizens to wear masks in public settings, specifically where it's difficult to maintain social distancing. Another tool in our reopening strategy is testing. Our daily testing capacity is already double the amount experts say is a must, and we're still adding more, much of which is thanks to the CARES Act funding. In January, while the World Health Organization was still saying it wasn't clear this virus could be spread person to person, and while China was not sharing all the data they had, we could not have imagined losing 100,000 of our fellow Americans, nor could we imagine dealing with one of the most prosperous economic periods in American history. For my community and all you represent, I ask you to challenge other nations and international health professionals to explain why more wasn't done at the origin to stop the silent killer from invading the United States. I respectfully request you consider additional federal funding for state and local governments that you can ensure is used for COVID-19 responses and not another excuse to repair bad choices made pre-COVID-19. Over 5 years of reigning in debt and implementing pension reform, Jacksonville put in place resources to sustain through a time of economic crisis. Local governments deserve access to the dollars they send to Washington, but not as a reward for poor fiscal decision-making. I appreciate the opportunity to tell Jacksonville's story. With smart planning and a shared vision for a new future, I'm certain all of us in this great nation will come back stronger than ever. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mayor Curry. We now recognize Mayor Garcetti for 5 minutes.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Chairman Clyburn. And thank you so much as well to Ranking Member Scalise. And thank you to my Congresswoman Maxine Waters, whose my heart breaks for you and the loss of your sister as well. And thank you to all my mayors who have talked about what's going on in Minneapolis. We are being tested not only in our physical health and our economic health, but this issue has brought forward the spiritual health of this country. And I appreciate all the words, and our hearts are with them and communities grieving everywhere. I come to you from the West Coast, the City of Angels, which is United States trade capital. It is our manufacturing capital. It is one of our apparel capitals. It is, of course, the entertainment capital that has been producing and showing everything you're watching during this pandemic. And we're happy to get you through these tough times. But we're also a great American city that reflects the diversity of our nation. And I'm very proud of some of the things we've done collectively as mayors and with your help in Washington to save lives. You can never count the lives saved, only those lost. But we know thousands and tens of thousands of people are alive here in Southern California and throughout the country because of the actions of brave governors who are red and blue and mayors who are red, blue, and mostly no color whatsoever. We know that here in Los Angeles, as one of the first cities to adopt a safer at home measure, to change the words that we use to describe this from sheltering in place to safer at home. The first city, big city in America, to have widespread testing available, not only to folks with symptoms, but without symptoms. And now the largest testing center in America at Dodger Stadium that can test 6,000 people a day with our own money. We know mayors rush to the fire, just as our first responders do, and that we comprise America through the 19,000 local communities. Here in Los Angeles, we've raised money to have the largest program of emergency cards for basic needs with cash assistance. And $53 million we've raised for that, and domestic violence for folks that have safer at home does not always mean safer at home. And we've housed just in 6 weeks, 3,000 Americans experiencing homelessness, thanks to FEMA allowing us to get people into hotel, motel rooms and shelters in our rec centers before they even are COVID-19 positive. We're the, I think, first big city to go in and mandate that every skilled nursing facility have testing. And we've done that with 100% now of our skilled nursing facilities. And one of the first cities, if not the first in America, to have an equity director, a COVID equity director, to look at, for instance, the disproportionate deaths in the African-American community, 9% of our county, initially 15% of our deaths, and to bring that down now to under the population represented by African-Americans. And I want to thank you for the CARES Act, which helped us do things like start the largest rental assistance program in the country, which will begin in a couple of weeks, $100 million to help mom and pop landlords and renters so that we don't grow homeless populations, add to insecurity, and have people lose their mortgages. But that's the good news. The grim news is here in Los Angeles, we have the highest unemployment in our history. It is higher than the Great Depression. So we have already entered what is a greater depression here in Los Angeles. We're taking $200 million from our reserve funds, implemented a 10% pay cut for all of our non-essential city employees. Places like Lima, Ohio, face 20% budget shortfalls. And I don't have to tell you as government leaders how devastating that is. But congressional action has always already shown it makes a big difference. When Republicans can vote for things like cash assistance and Democrats can step up and help our first responders, we start to erode these walls that classify us first and foremost by our party affiliation before our personal qualities, our characteristics, and our joint patriotism. We need a lot from you. And so I'm going to be blunt about what those are. We need $250 billion now with guardrails, an infrastructure package that will help move jobs forward, and a CARES Corps that could bring as many as 100,000 out-of-work Americans to help us with those things like contact tracing. You know, America lives in our local communities. And on June 30th, that is our cliff. 46 states and almost every city and county in America begins a new fiscal year. And if there is not assistance there, the biggest sector facing job loss in America right now, the stats that'll be on all of our records now, is local government employees. On Saturday, we will launch the first American-made rocket with American astronauts launched from American soil in a long time into the heavens. That rocket was built here in Los Angeles, and it's a reminder of what we can do as Americans when it embodies in many ways our innovation and our will, our power to realize the impossible. Let us summon that right now and get rid of these false dichotomies of who's red and blue and who manages our city. We did the biggest pension reform in the country, and we've seen red states also, or red counties go bankrupt. It is not Republican or Democratic. It is at this point a United States of America. And we thank you for what you will do to save this country. And we are your soldiers on the front line, ready to take that money and to save our economy and to save our people. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Mayor Garcetti. And thanks to all of our panelists here today. We're now going to recognize members for 5 minutes each to ask questions. And I'm going to lead off the questions. And then I'll yield to Ranking Member Scalise for his 5 minutes. My question goes to Mayor Benjamin. Mayor Benjamin, when you very boldly, and I think with great innovation, took action here in Columbia, let me read to you what you said. We are about to go into one of our darkest periods in the last 100 plus years. We need to be prepared on the front end to do everything we can to save lives. Now, you were castigated when you took the action, but I applauded it. And I want you to share with us what you feel, the impact on saving lives that your action made.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. It was simply the right thing to do. We have always been guided by our true north, which when you take into all the various concerns and considerations that my colleagues have articulated this morning, this afternoon, our true north has always been the preservation of human life. That you can't be pro-business without being pro-public health, and that we had to be driven by good, solid public health data, driven by testing and contact tracing and supported isolation. But testing gives you good data. Data gives you intelligence. Intelligence allows you to make good, sound public policy decisions, and the urgency of acting quickly when all the facts are not yet clear. And this virus, respects no authority, respects no borders, is indeed changed over time. But our response has had to be consistent. It's had to be transparent, and it has had to be compassionate. There's a way in which we can approach this, and that's why I thank Congress for its deliberate and intentional actions early on to respond to the economic and public health crises, but also restate the importance that we have to do more. The reality, as articulated by several of my colleagues, is that America's cities are helping drive the American economy. 85% of our citizens live in cities and metro areas. 89% of the jobs are in cities and metropolitan areas. That 92% of America's gross domestic product is created in cities and metropolitan areas, driven by thriving towns, villages, and large cities as large as New York and Los Angeles and the others. The only way we can do this is if we can do it together, but with a sound and compassionate approach to using public health data to drive that response. We believe that we have presented one of the great models for American leadership because, in fact, we've done it together with a diverse council, Republicans, Democrats, and independents alike, all acting with a degree of not only gravity, but also the sincerity that recognizes the fragility of the human condition. Our true north has always been the preservation of human life. That will not change, Mr. Congressman. Thank you so much.
And thank you so much for that, Mayor Benjamin. I want to ask Mayor Scott. Mayor Scott, you represent a very rural area. I think you said that you have closed 7 hospitals, rural hospitals, and what that's done for the healthcare delivery in your area. We've lost 4 here in South Carolina. Share with us, if you please, what you are doing now that you don't have these facilities available to your citizens.
Well, right now, as far as Mangum goes in Southwest Oklahoma, we do have our critical access hospital, which I like to tell people the reason why we even have a hospital in the town of Mangum is because we are within 30 miles of some other hospitals, but because we have a railroad track between us and them, then we're allowed to have a critical access hospital in our town, which allows us to do emergency treatments and things like that. They do a lot of skilled nursing. It's as far as Southwest Oklahoma goes, we're just small. We only have 18 beds. And whenever the coronavirus hit, we had to set up part of a wing, but there were only 2 or 3 beds. And right now, we only have 2 ventilators in our hospital. So the small rural hospitals, when you start looking on up north of us and a little bit back west, some people have to drive 50 miles just to get to a hospital. But what we're doing right now, we're lucky that we have our hospital. And this is what I'm worried about, is that this is going to cause our hospital financial stress, that we're not going to be able to keep it if this continues.
Thank you very much for that. I think the Heroes Act has some help for you, and I hope we can get it passed. With that, I'll yield to Ranking Member Scalise for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman Clyburn, and thank all of our mayors again. I do want to join with all in first expressing my deep disappointment and anger at what happened with this death of George Floyd. It shouldn't have happened. Justice needs to happen, but the violence needs to stop as well. And I know our former colleague, Tim Walls and Keith Ellison, who were there in Minnesota, I have confidence that they are going to ensure that justice is carried out. And so our prayers are with them, and our calls for justice are there too. I do want to touch on a few things. First, Mayor Benjamin, you can be very proud of your native son, your constituent, and your congressman, James Clyburn. We have a deep friendship, but we also respect the job he does. So you can be proud of the representative that you sent to Washington. I do want to touch on some of the differences in things that we've talked about in terms of how to reopen safely and how mayors play such a key role, and also how the guidance has at least helped to allow for everybody to work through what they know best in their own community. Because I know there might be a disagreement on this, but the recovery and the safe reopening of our economy is not a one-size-fits-all approach. The president's done a good job of giving guidance from health experts, CDC, CMS, so many other agencies where you have health experts giving guidance. But ultimately, the governors working with local government and mayors are the ones making the decision, because even within communities, you're not seeing the exact reaction. Some communities are doing better than others. Some communities need to reopen differently than others and are doing it that way. Some with success and some not with success. And I think where the focus needs to be is on finding those areas where things are going well and sharing those with those communities where things aren't going well. Because in too many cases, we've seen that a one-size-fits-all approach doesn't work, but also that the people that aren't doing it well aren't sharing information and finding out how things are going well. I want to ask Mayor Curry, you touched on a few things. One that I really was interested in, and something we've been talking about a lot, is that is the cost of not opening. Because while we look at the COVID deaths and we mourn the COVID deaths, in my home parish, we saw a dramatic increase, over 40% deaths, higher death rate in Jefferson Parish this same six-week period this year compared to last year. The coroner did a study and found that there was a 42% increase in non-COVID deaths this year because people aren't getting themselves taken care of, going to their doctors, getting the immunizations. And you talked about the opioid uptick. Can you share what you've seen in your community from those people that are affected that are not dying from COVID-related but are seeing other kind of impacts?
Yes, thank you, Ranking Member Scalise, for the question. Obviously, the COVID-19 deaths have been tragic throughout the country and through every community that has faced them. We've had people that have passed away without being able to be with their family members that weren't able to be there to comfort them. In addition, though, we've also had additional effects because of the lockdown that had to happen to flatten the curve. But an extended lockdown is not sustainable. Our opioid 911 calls are frankly through the roof given the same period of last year. I asked weeks ago, long before people were discussing it, I asked my fire and rescue department to do an analysis of transports of people with non-COVID related things like heart issues or any number of issues that could be fatal. And they were way down. People were putting off going to the doctor in the hospital because they were afraid to be around medical facilities because of COVID-19. Mental health issues. The strain and crisis of small businesses. I remember about 2 weeks into this, I was getting takeout at a local restaurant, talking to the owner about the struggle, how real it was, the stress to have to potentially lay people off. What we did at that point in time was we partnered with local credit union, ViStar, and were able to come up with $30 million in city and bank loans and grants to help people keep people employed. I guess
let me jump in here. I'm sorry, because yes. I know there are a couple other things I want to hit on in limited time. I do want to thank you, by the way, too, for mentioning in your open statement, the importance of holding China accountable. Some of us have talked a lot about the role that China plays and that it should be a priority of this committee to hold China accountable. It's where the disease started. I also want to bring up something that we talk about disparity in populations, and clearly there's been some disparities. One, and maybe the most glaring, has been with our seniors in nursing homes. It's been just devastating to see how nursing homes have been impacted by this. But once again, there is no one-size-fits-all approach, because some communities have had success, some haven't. And I'll just point to two states. And obviously in your state, we've looked at the numbers, but you contrast that with New York, in the state of New York, where they had the highest death rate from seniors in nursing homes. And if you look, CMS came out with a protocol March 13th that talked about how to properly deal with people in nursing homes who went to hospitals who tested positive for COVID. And they were very clear that if you were positive, the nursing home shouldn't take them back if there's not a way for the nursing home to properly care for them, to quarantine for them. And yet in New York, for whatever reason, the governor gave a mandate that the nursing homes had to take them back even if they were positive. In fact, he prohibited the nursing homes from testing those people. He gave a mandate, quote, nursing homes don't have the right to object to accepting a COVID positive patient. And the result of that was devastating. It was fatally devastating. There was a 900% increase in nursing home deaths in New York compared to the state of Florida. We see the whole country, 0.6% of our country are in nursing homes, yet 42% of the COVID deaths are nursing home patients. But again, when you dig into the number, not all nursing home patients are treated the same because each state regulates them. One state, the example, New York, very different outcome than your state of Florida. Again, 900% more nursing home deaths in New York than Florida. Can you explain what y'all did, Governor DeSantis, even in your own community in Jacksonville, to better protect nursing home patients who were COVID positive?
Sure. Thank you again for that question. Governor DeSantis was a leader on the front end of this. He immediately worked with all of our cities in our state, Jacksonville in particular. On March 14th, we realized that elderly residents, in partnership with our governor and his leadership, they were lacking PPE equipment. Immediate distribution of N95 masks, surgical masks, bottles of hand sanitizers. A strike team task force were established by our governor with the National Guard to make sure we were getting into these nursing homes, skilled nursing facilities, testing people. And one of the really important things was someone goes from one of these facilities to a hospital, they test positive. The governor made sure they were not sent back to that facility, where other, unfortunately, states did that, and it spread like wildfire. Governor DeSantis also, early in this pandemic, went to Washington. I think most of us saw that. It was televised. He spent time with the president to talk about, President Trump, to talk about best practices. So I believe our governor, our state, we got it right on the front end, and this is going to be key as we reopen. We got to make sure we're taking care of the most vulnerable. We got to get people back to work.
Much, Mr. Mayor. My ranking member and my great friend, thank you. But we're long since past the 5-minute mark. So let me now go to Chair Lady Maxine Waters.
Thank you so very much, Chairman Clyburn, for having these mayors with us today, both the larger cities and the smaller cities, helping us to understand what they're confronted with. I am so very pleased that you're focusing on them today, and I'm so very pleased that our Heroes Act is focusing on our cities. We know that these cities and states have to balance their budgets, and we know that they need help. And so that's why it's so important for us to pass this Heroes Act. So I'm very pleased, again, that these mayors are here with us today to share what is going on in their cities. Allow me to take a moment to especially thank my mayor, Mayor Eric Garcetti, for his leadership. He's one of the mayors in this country who have shown not only superb leadership, but a lot of creativity. When he talked about cash payments to our citizens, money that they went out and helped to raise, that's the kind of extra step that he is taking to do everything that he can to deal with this pandemic and the fact that so many people are suffering. I'd like to just ask, he did not say a word about LAX. LAX, Los Angeles Airport, is in my district, and it is a huge economic engine in the district. And so it is the fourth busiest airport in the world prior to COVID-19, based on the number of passengers, the impact of LAX on our nation's travel and communication infrastructure, and its importance to the city of Los Angeles and my district in particular, cannot be overstated. According to a report by the Los Angeles Economic Development Corporation, before the COVID-19 pandemic, LAX supported over 620,000 jobs, which generated more than $125 billion in revenue for local economies, $37 billion in labor income, almost $9 billion in federal taxes, over $6 billion in state and local taxes. It is a foundation of the Los Angeles community and one of the busiest airports in the entire world. This is why during the CARES Act negotiations, I sent a letter to House leadership requesting that any pandemic relief legislation include funding for our nation's airports. My letter also requested funding for other sectors of the airport community, such as minority-owned airport concessionaires. So I was pleased that my request and the request of other members of Congress was heard, and the CARES Act provided $10 billion specifically for airports, more than $323 million of which was provided to LAX. However, I fear this may not be enough. The loss of revenue caused by the pandemic has left LAX struggling to meet its debt obligations and remain in business. And I've seen some estimates that LAX could need as much as $500 million to weather the current crisis. So I'd like to ask Mayor Garcetti, was the airport funding in the CARES Act sufficient to make LAX whole? If not, how much more does LAX need in order to meet its debt obligations and continue to operate safely? And what are the consequences to Los Angeles and the greater country, county and country, if Congress fails to act?
Well, thank you so much, Chairwoman, not only for your kind words, but even more importantly, for your fierce advocacy on this in your district and for our country. There's no question, and I'm sure Mayor Lance Bottoms is glad you asked this question. She has the busiest airport in the world. We have the fourth busiest airport in the world and the busiest of origination and destination where people get off the plane or get on the plane in that city. Thank you for what you did in the CARES Act. We are able to pass that on to companies to give rent breaks to keep their employees employed. So unemployment was kept away by the work that you did there. After 9/11, we saw traffic drop in half, and it took a decade to rebuild it. Now it's down 95%. So yes, the HEROES Act has no funding for airports. LAX needs $200 million for this year and $500 million to get probably through the next year, next 12 months, to just get to its debt obligations. And there are thousands of workers right now building things at that airport, American tradesmen and women. And we've heard from JFK, SeaTac, Miami, Atlanta, O'Hare, we have the same funding issues. So please.
Thank you so much. Our time is just about a word about the rental program that you have. I have $100 billion in the HEROES Act, but I want to know how that's going to work with what you're doing in rental assistance, because you have a $100 million program.
Absolutely. It could finish it off in a great way. We're probably going to hit, it's the biggest in the country, but we'll probably hit at best somewhere between 5 and 10% of those folks who are 80% of the area median income or below, the working poor who have lost their jobs because of COVID-19. It is a model to begin with, but with your leadership, we could see as much as half of the city be able to get through some months of assistance as we reopen the economy and get them back to work. It's the difference between being homeless and not.
Thank you very much, Madam Waters, and thank you, Mayor Garcetti. The chair now recognizes Mr. Jordan for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Clyburn. Mayor Garcetti, first of all, it's Lima, Ohio, not Lima. Mayor Curry, I got some questions for you.
I know, my bad, thank you.
Mayor Curry, the Attorney General of the United States, just a little over a month ago, sent a memo to all U.S. attorneys. The subject line was preservation of civil rights. In that memo, he said the Constitution is not suspended during a crisis. Do you agree with that statement from the Attorney General, Mayor Curry?
100%.
Good. Yes. Did you or your, and I figured you did based on the actions that you took in your state and your city. Mayor Curry, did you or your state's governor close churches?
We did not close churches.
Did you or your state's governor close gun stores, any gun shops?
We did not.
Did you or your state's governor encourage residents to snitch on their neighbors?
Absolutely not. In fact, yesterday I have a press conference. I'm encouraging people to wear masks when they're in dense places, but that's a personal decision. While I strongly encourage it and I do it, I've told people, you don't need to be policing your neighbors. This isn't a police state. This is the land of the free and the home of the brave.
We appreciate that. And Jacksonville and the state of Florida are largely opening up now. Is that right? I mean, you're close, as close to being back to normal as probably any other state in the country.
We're very close with some capacity limitations, and we've got youth camps and sports starting in the weeks ahead.
I want to thank you and your governor for the positions you've taken. And as you have largely opened up, not infringing on anyone's civil liberties, you've done so in a way to still protect the safety and health of your residents in your city and around your state. Is that true?
That's correct. Protect the most vulnerable. Make sure people with compromised immune systems, we encourage them to act responsibly, their families to act responsibly. But let me add that through Congress and President Trump's leadership, we have received, look, a top-down approach doesn't work because every city and community is different, but we've received what we need every step of the way from the Trump administration, from you guys, the United States Congress, and we've been able to act accordingly with testing, protecting people, and protecting their rights.
Mayor, I want to say thank you to you. I want to say thank you for not closing churches, not closing gun shops, not encouraging neighbors to rat out their fellow citizens and their people in their community. And what a contrast that is with other cities and states. And frankly, what a contrast that is with Mayor Garcetti and Governor Newsom. Governor Newsom closed churches in California and was sued. Mayor Garcetti closed gun shops in Los Angeles and was sued. Mayor Garcetti said this, snitches get rewards. I don't know what that means. I don't know if that means if you rat out your neighbor, snitch on your neighbor, if you get some kind of certificate from the city, or you get some type of medal, or I have no idea what that means. Some cities, the Mayor de Blasio set up a hotline where people could call in and report their neighbor. Some mom is in the park with their kids and they're going to get snitched on and reported. Some kids are playing basketball in the park and they're going to get reported. So I want to thank you for the positions you've taken. And just last week, again, highlighting the contrast between Jacksonville and Florida and other places, just last week, the Department of Justice sent a letter to Mayor Garcetti talking about the heavy-handed approach he's taken in Los Angeles. Mayor Curry, are you allowing kids to play soccer and opening up sports leagues this summer in your city?
So right now, effective last Friday, working with our governor, Governor DeSantis, private athletic associations they're free to do what they want at this point. We encourage, obviously, the social distancing, safe acts, personal responsibility and decisions, though. City camps that are run by the summer camps run by the city will begin opening within the next week. And we're getting back to normal. By the way, our percentage of positives has consistently been trending down. We're down around 3%. That's been consistent. You can be pro jobs, pro economy, and do it in a safe, responsible way with COVID-19.
Yeah. And have you opened your beaches in your city too? Beaches open in your city and your state?
I'm sorry for laughing. We opened our beaches, about 4 weeks ago and got all kind of national media saying that the death march was coming to Jacksonville, that we were a bunch of morons. I went with the data, open space, people can socially distance, they can exercise. This was in the peak of it. This was in the middle of it all. People got out and behaved responsibly, and our beaches didn't create any negative health outcomes.
And all these results, all this progress, and never once did you make any type of public announcement encouraging people to snitch on their neighbors. Is that right?
That is correct. In fact, yeah. I'm continuing to. I said yesterday, if you see somebody in a mask and you don't like it, leave them alone. If someone doesn't have a mask on, stay away from them if you're not comfortable. Make your own personal responsible decisions.
Mayor, I want to thank you for the kind of leadership we appreciate, and I think your residents appreciate. And I want to thank you mostly as someone who sits on the Judiciary Committee for respecting the Constitution throughout this process and doing exactly, following exactly what the Attorney General of the United States said, which is during crisis, the Constitution still stands. So thank you, and thank you for being with us today. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And I understand that Mayor Durkin has asked for a minute to respond to something. Mayor Durkin? Yes,
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. I'd like to respond with due respect to Congressman Jordan. Having been a former U.S. attorney and a member of the Department of Justice, to insinuate that any city in America is trying to restrict liberties is not helpful at this time. We must fight this virus as a country. There are no garbage cans or blue garbage cans.
The Justice Department sent the letter. I didn't send the letter. The Justice Department last week sent a letter to Mayor Garcetti. All I'm talking about is when you close down churches, that's a violation of the First Amendment. When you sell gun shops aren't essential, I think that's infringing on the Second Amendment. If you don't think that, then that you can take that up with your residents. But to me, this is real basic. It's about the Constitution.
That's right.
I choose to not suspend the Constitution, as the Attorney General said, during a crisis. You may have a different approach. I don't.
Nobody has suspended the Constitution. The leaders of faith stood up with me and with the governor saying, we don't want to hold services. We respect the sanctity of life. And so to insinuate that Mayor Garcetti or Governor Newsom is not fighting for the health of their people and residents, frankly,
I didn't say that. I was talking about the Constitution.
It is not helpful. And let me say this. What we're here today is to ask Congress, not for bumper stickers, but for help. I spent last weekend at our national cemetery visiting the parents' graves, my parents' graves, who fought for this nation. And when World War II started, all of our rubber was cut off. We had no supplies for our Jeep tires, our airplane tires.
Mayor, Did you set up a snitch line like Mayor de Blasio did?
Today, cities, states are fighting to get the weapons they need to fight this virus. Please help us.
Let me take back the time, exert my authority as chair here, and I'm now going to recognize Ms. Maloney.
And Member Scalise and all of my colleagues that are here today, and particularly the mayors that are on the front line combating this war against the virus. We are looking to you to learn from you. We thank you for being here today. 2 weeks ago, bipartisan public health officials told the Select Committee that for our communities to reopen, we need a coordinated plan for testing, contact tracing, and containment. Yet the White House has made it very clear that state and local governments are basically on their own. Just this week, the White House released a testing plan that calls on the states to, quote, establish a robust testing program that ensures adequacy of COVID-19 testing, assures provisions are in place to meet future surge capacity testing needs, end quote. So that sounds, I must say, very much like the federal government's job to me. So I'd like to ask Mayor Durkin, I can see you're a fighter. In an interview earlier this month, you said, and I quote, you have state versus state, city versus city competing since the beginning of this pandemic. The only way to avoid that is for the national government to do what it needs to do. And you called on the federal government to use the Defense Production Act. So Mayor Durkin, can you tell us about the difficulties Seattle faced over the past few months procuring personal protective equipment and testing supplies? You were the first state hit. Share with us your experiences. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Congresswoman. It really has been a battle, I know, for Seattle and for every state. We saw very quickly that our frontline healthcare workers didn't have the protective equipment they needed. Either did our fire police. So we started scouring literally the world to try to get masks. We ran into the same thing for testing. And even today, we have not been able to get adequate testing for our residents in Seattle. Because of a relationship I had with the mayor of Seoul, South Korea, we're going to be getting testing supplies from South Korea. Mm-hmm. America needs to fight this battle together. We need to join hands, and really the generational challenge is ours today. And we need to come together and get the equipment that we need in every city and every town across America. Let's fight this together and win it together.
Well, Mayor Durkin, can you elaborate on how cities are competing against each other for testing resources and protective equipment.
Yes, exactly. We've had events at the very beginning when we literally, with the state of Washington, were going to be bidding on getting masks that were at the harbor in LA, and instead a different mayor or a different state got them. New York was in desperate straits, so they were bidding up the cost of everything. We were able to get test kits from other places that didn't work. I know some mayors who say that they had to go on eBay to see if they could get masks and equipment to protect healthcare workers and their first responders. We're the greatest country in the world. We can respond to this. Let's harness the power of America. We're in the fight of our lives.
Thank you. And Mayor Durkin, as cities move to reopen their economies and prepare for a possible second wave of the virus, how important is it for the federal government to have a centralized process to procure and distribute these supplies?
It's absolutely essential because we can't afford to let that virus come back. And think of testing as being the radar that lets us know when the virus is coming so that we can fight it. And so if any city in America is left without, they'll be left behind. And we need to reopen our economies. Everybody wants to do that. We want to come together. But we need the supplies, and we need them in every city in America.
And Mayor Durkin, I agree with your position that we must look towards increasing manufacturing capabilities, including using American factories to create some of these supplies. And we've done that in New York. We've opened up four different factories that are sewing the masks and the gowns up. And I believe that we should really produce this, a certain percentage of it, in America. Would you agree with that statement that why aren't we producing more of it here in America?
Absolutely. We have the best workers, the most innovative companies. We could be creating and producing everything we need here. And that's what we need to do. The Defense Procurement Act and Production Acts will harness the ingenuity of America. And with that, we can open up our businesses, prevail in our economy, and beat this virus.
Well, I will be requesting a GAO report, a bipartisan report, to conduct a study on how to improve the PPE supply chain, including an analysis of whether we should be manufacturing more PPE in the United States. I don't want to ever have to be dependent on a foreign country as you have, and as you are now, reaching out to a foreign country to get the supplies that you need. Would you support requiring a certain percentage of PPE being developed here in America?
Absolutely. And again, I think with the manufacturing capability and the genius of America, we can get all of the supplies we need, we can develop the vaccine, and we can make sure it's distributed to every American for free.
Thank you very much. Ms. Maloney, your time has expired.
Thank you.
The chair now recognizes Congressman Lukumanmaiya.
Thank you, Chairman Clyburn and Ranking Member Scalise, and thank all of our panelists today for briefing our select committee. Our economy has taken an extremely hard hit and brought us to the highest number of unemployment filings since the Great Depression, over 40 million. And while I acknowledge that coronavirus has brought severe health risks to our country, we need to look at another approach other than simply shutting down our economy should a second wave hit. I think one of the things that's concerning to me is as the data continues to roll in, we are trying to take sides in this situation where one group looks at only the coronavirus, and we have another group that's looking at the other side of the balance sheet here of the health and welfare of our citizens and our economy. This past week, there was an article in the Hill, for instance, three different engineers, scientists, health professionals came up with some of the latest data on our economy and how it's being affected. It said here the average estimate of the loss of a life over the next several months due to the economic shutdown is we're looking at 65,000 lives per month based on suicides, overdoses, all those other sorts of things. Here's some other statistics. Emergence 650,000 cancer patients receiving chemotherapy, estimated half of them miss their treatments. 150,000 new cancer cases that are typically diagnosed aren't being diagnosed. By probably as much as two thirds to three fourths, over half the childhood vaccinations are not being performed. this is going to be a tragedy that we have never, that's beyond description here if we don't start thinking on the other side of this balance sheet. But I want to keep people's minds here that just don't look at this as a ball game where you look at so many deaths on this side of the sheet and so many deaths on that. We're talking about people's lives. We should be looking at all the lives, and reopening is important to get this other side of the balance sheet to where we can keep people from being harmed on that side. I know, Mayor Curry, you have been aggressive in getting your state and your city in particular open. I know you mentioned a while ago you've increased in drug overdoses as a result of the shutdown. Do you think your city can survive a second shutdown should another coronavirus second wave pop up here?
Well, anytime you're making thank you for the question, Representative. Anytime you're making decisions, you know, they say never because you never know what will come. But I will say this, and I've said before, I do not believe another shutdown is sustainable. I do not believe it's an option. The virus is with us. We now know that it affects those with compromised immune systems, the assisted living facilities. So we have to do business in a way that's responsible and make sure that we protect those that are most vulnerable.
Thank you. I know the CDC, even in action this past week, said it's time to get everybody open and get going again, which I think is very important. A number of you mentioned this morning about data, how important data is. You're data-driven. Mayor Barnett, I know you represent all the mayors across the country here. You made a comment that it's, locally executing reopening is how things should be done. But when you talk about data, I saw a piece of information this week with regards to vaccinations. It really concerned me. It said that over 50% of the people are not willing or to either get a shot or would not want to take a shot. How are you going to reopen? What is your plan down the road to maintain being open if you can't vaccinate? Because a lot of folks say, well, we're not going to open until we get a vaccination. Well, what happens if we don't get a vaccine? We don't have a vaccine for HIV. We don't have a vaccine for Ebola. We have a vaccine for SARS. What happens if we don't get a vaccine for the coronavirus? And 50% of the people, even if we do get one, don't want to take the shot. How will you address that situation with your city?
Sure. It's a great question. Thank you, Congressman. I appreciate it. I think this is where I tend to be optimistic about the way Americans, red and blue, and particularly the way mayors have led. I think we are using this opportunity. I'm from a state where our governor has chosen a very strict shutdown process. But within that, what we're trying to do in our city is understand how we can operate, how we can reimagine, how we can innovate. And I think we're going to have to do that. I agree with you. A second shutdown would be catastrophic in our community and across this country. So what have we learned through this first shutdown that would allow us to deal with some of the things you're talking about? A quick example here, I think we've learned how to operate. If we were to have some sort of restrictions on us, we've learned to do all the kinds of inspections virtually, where we don't have to do them in person anymore. As it relates to vaccinations, every industry, every mayor, every city is going to have to look and reimagine how they operate. You're exactly right about the need for us to imagine this differently. And in order for our country to regain the confidence, we're going to have to tackle some of these really tough questions.
I just have one comment. I know my time is up here, but I know that Mayor Benjamin made the comment a minute ago about the municipal bond market and support that the Treasury and Fed put out there so that they would be able to shore up the municipal bond market and keep it adequate for the bond market not to collapse. And I appreciate that comment because I said in financial services, this was a big deal. We were working on this for quite a while. The Fed and Treasury put together a program to prop up the market to make sure that the bond market didn't collapse. And I appreciate that comment. With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back. Thank you very much.
Thank you for yielding back the time. The chair now recognizes Mr. Foster.
Well, thank you to all of our mayors here. You serve at the level of government that I think is probably provides the most personal satisfaction because you get to make decisions and see those decisions reflected as you drive by the people that you represent every day. So, and I also want to second the advocacy of Mayor Benjamin for extending the direct support for municipal bonds by the Federal Reserve to cities with populations below 250,000. I have in my district the second, third, and fourth largest cities of Illinois, Aurora, Joliet, and Naperville, but none of them qualify for direct muni bond support from the Fed. And we're working as hard as we can to to change this, both at the state level and the federal level. Now, public health experts have warned that the American people must prepare for a second wave of coronavirus later this year. Dr. Robert Redfield, the director of the CDC, has warned, quote, there's a possibility that the assault by the virus on our nation next winter will actually be even more difficult than the one that we just went through. And there's a lot of historic precedent for this. Mayor Garcetti, you've been warning about the possible resurgence of the virus since March. And you've called the current lockdown, quote, the first battle of the fight. So as cities all over the country take steps to reopen their economy, what are the key elements that are necessary to have in place to limit the spread of virus and respond quickly to a possible second wave? And secondly, how do you explain to people who are bone weary of being closed and locked down that unless they take hygiene and social distancing seriously, that they're very likely to be right back where we started within a few weeks?
Well, great questions, Congressman, and thank you. It's exactly living in the gray that we've done these myths of places that are completely closed or completely open. Everybody is living in this gray until we have a cure in every country in the world and every city in America. There are key things, though. We're not moving beyond COVID-19. We're learning to live with it. We're learning to be smarter and better. For instance, in Los Angeles, with much criticism, I kept our construction trades open the entire time. We brought inspectors in to make sure that there was safe PPE for our workers, the men and women who are carpenters and our electricians and others. We made sure there were folks on site that were educated and encouraged about that. And it really wasn't about enforcement. These myths and these kind of caricatures, we were able to not see any outbreaks in our construction trades. And that became the model for what we're doing successively in other places where we're opening up. So, you know, you have to follow your hospital beds. You've got to stand up testing in particular. And I'm very proud because we had no money. We have to take this out of our own budget. Even our county didn't give us money. And I said I would test anybody in the 10 million county area, even though I'm responsible for 4 million, because that's what the medical experts said was important to do. So we stood up testing. We said asymptomatic testing to find the silent spreaders. And then we're putting a real focus. As I said, we've gone into every single skilled nursing home. And I just want to say briefly, this is a virus that thrives off of division. You know, people die when we are divided. And I came here to praise and unite and not to insult and to divide, to share what's working and not to score political points. So I appreciate that. I hope that we can all show respect and be respected and appeal to our better angels and not become a bunch of a pit of wrestling demons. I know that you serve on this committee because you want to hear what works, but testing and giving that assistance to the state and local level is absolutely critical for all of us who uphold our Constitution. As elected officials, we take that oath. As a veteran, I've taken that oath. And I'm proud to do that alongside my mayors and each one of you.
Thank you. And, you know, we've had a little bit of talk here, which I think is important, you know, about the trade-off between spending money and, you know, and saving human lives. It's a decision we make in Congress every day, every time we take a vote. There's an element of that, and it can't be the only consideration because of how precious human lives are, but it has to be a factor. And I just want to point out that the cost of wearing a mask is near zero. And so I just want to have, you know, any mayor who wants to pipe up on this. But what do you actually say to someone when you see people saying, great, the businesses are now open, so I don't need to wear a mask, even when they're walking right close to people and not obeying social distancing? You know, how do you handle that problem? Any mayor that wants to jump in?
I'd be happy to do so. Mayor Barnett was kind enough to appoint me as a chairman of Mayors for Masks for the United States Conference of Mayors, Congressman Foster. It is a simple action that we can all do to not only protect our own personal health. God gives us one temple that we have to take care of and preserve for hopefully a long time to be with the people that we love. And then the role of mutual responsibility, just making sure that we are our brother's keeper, our sister's keeper. It's simple. Just as you said, it costs nothing. It is a simple accommodation that allows us to make sure that we're able to corral the spread of this virus, back it up with the testing, tracing, and supported isolation that the chairman mentioned earlier is so important. I would be remiss if I didn't say quickly, the work that you've done thus far, again, we're thankful for it. We've had a number of different conversations here that have nothing to do with the topic that we're discussing here today. And I want to, again, encourage Congress to move with the same amount of gravity and speed to address the real issues that we're talking about here. How, in fact, do we sustain a level of basic services to citizens that take care of us every single day? We're not talking about money falling from DC like manna from heaven. We're talking about the repatriation of tax dollars back to the local level where we can take care of our citizens' needs. Mr. Chairman, I would be remiss if I didn't say before we left that we've seen some great challenges emerge, obviously illuminating some of the Achilles heels of American society right now. One that I know you're passionate about is the digital divide, the challenges that we're seeing as we talk about the next greatest thing, the challenges that we're seeing and the opportunities to make sure that we're connected with all of our citizens in urban and rural America alike and the suburbs too. We saw in April a survey of South Carolina teachers, only 17% of them have been able to contact all of their students. In our state alone, our state superintendent of education indicates that between 31 and 39,000 students have not been in contact with their schools since schools shut down. We recognize that there's some major challenges that we can address as a country working together right now, and that while social distancing is important to corral the spread of this virus, that obviously that we also realize it's economically ruinous. These are not mutually exclusive. We can work together, and we also want to make sure it's clear that cities are not a special interest, that we're working for the same people. Let's see if we can do that together. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mayor Benjamin, and thank you, Mr. Foster. The chair now recognizes Ms. Orleski.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. All of our witnesses who are here today as well. I want to start by thanking our hardworking mayors, all of our elected officials in my district that have worked together on task force, and our healthcare workers as well. I want to thank our governor, Governor Eric Holcomb, for making Indiana a leader on coronavirus response and transparency. The state's five-phase reopening plan is a responsible way to restart our economy while still working to contain the spread and flatten the curve. Indiana also pioneered a first-of-its-kind small business PPE workplace where eligible small businesses could apply for bundles of face masks, face shields, hand sanitizer free of charge. The marketplace has fulfilled more than 20,000 orders so far. Just want to give a shout-out real quick to Mayor Durkin. Give us a shout-out in the Hoosier State. We are in full production because of the Defense Production Act of domestically producing large supplies of PPE. I'll also note that Indiana is being open and transparent about how it's using federal funds. Governor Holcomb recently detailed to the Indiana delegation how the state used its $5 billion in federal funding on comprehensive testing, costs for emergency operation centers, PPE for critical workers and businesses, long-term care strike teams, congregate homes and child care providers, and a $300 million grant assistance program to our local communities. The coronavirus is unlike any in our lifetimes, and our country has experienced a devastating loss of life. Emergency actions like stay-at-home orders were necessary to slow the spread and flatten the curve, but we're also seeing a broader toll on Americans' health that we just can't ignore, such as adverse outcomes for women's health and individuals with substance abuse. We need to protect women's health by ensuring they can see their OBGYN, receive a mammogram, and give birth in a hospital without fear. In my district, the local domestic abuse crisis line saw a 50% jump in calls as well. We're seeing drug overdoses back on the rise. I commend the Trump administration for enabling telehealth treatment, but safely reopening our mental health facilities is vital to stop the spread of this addiction to opioids and other drugs that continue to plague our communities. But let's talk about what mayors need to safely reopen. There's things like we've talked about, PPE, testing, tracing. Every opening plan should have those. But I think something that we need to talk about with less hyperbole and more nuance is how we talk about making these decisions. Mayor Curry, just a shout out here. As the state of Georgia began to reopen plans, the Washington Post declared, and you already alluded to this, that you lead the race to be in this state of Georgia. They were leading the race to become America's number one death destination. The Atlantic called Georgia an experiment in human sacrifice, which was so unfair, just irresponsible. And then all too often, we see articles ignoring critical nuances or burying these numbers. A headline can sound like an alarm and spike cases,
And at the same time, some kind of rationale and explanation, like a decrease in the rate of positive tests or a decrease in hospitalization, never gets reported at all. And sometimes our eyes can be deceived. Just like in Jacksonville, when you open those beaches and the headlines talked about, look at the overcrowding, look at the irresponsible people. And yet you would see a picture zoomed in on people. But if you saw an aerial view, they were still social distancing. It just depend on the kind of picture and the perspective that it showed. But you know what? We're so far past that of media calling people irresponsible when you're trying to do the right thing. I just want to use the time I have left to talk with Mayor Curry about when Jacksonville did reopen its beaches. The hashtag was hashtag Florida morons trended nationally. Needless to say, that coverage wasn't helpful. It wasn't charitable. Can you talk about how that affected your ability to manage your own city and communicate with your own citizens about reopening? And can you also talk about the role of this hyperbole and nuance in the reopening discussion?
Sure. Thank you, Representative. Appreciate the opportunity. I did the best I could to ignore the national media when that was happening. I promised the citizens of my city that I would be transparent with them, share information with them as I had it, take advice from physicians and scientists, but recognizing that those of us that are elected have to make decisions with all of the input of those around us. It's on us to make those decisions. And some of that goes with experience. Essential businesses included grocery stores, other facilities that were open during the stay-at-home, safer-at-home orders. Our daycare centers in the state of Florida never closed down. So my experience was you had people in grocery stores, you had people in daycare centers for weeks, and we didn't have hot spots and outbreaks. So it made sense that outdoor activity on an open space in a beach would be a safe place to move. Go back to where our governor led on the front end, and he worked with President Trump. Assisting living facilities, respiratory issues, compromised immune system. That's where we need to focus. That's the people we need to protect.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Chairman, thank you. I yield back.
Thank you very much. I now recognize Mr. Raskin.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I join the calls and prayers for justice and for peace in Minnesota, where the Floyd family is still experiencing unspeakable grief in the wake of the killing of their loved one. Mr. Chairman, thank you for calling this important hearing today. This committee is the anti-swamp, where we take on every insider scheme to rip off the American people and steal the resources that we have invested as a country in economic and public health recovery. Our focus is on making American government work for the people, and that means promoting the nationwide federal public health testing, contact tracing, and quarantine strategy that has been missing from the beginning of this crisis. Mr. Chairman, it's amazing to me that some people think that the Constitution grants a special religious exemption from general public health orders. The Constitution doesn't even provide special religious exemption for any neutral, universally applicable law. And for that proposition, you can just go read Justice Scalia's very learned opinion in Employment Division versus Smith. If there's a rule that anybody assembling in groups of more than 25, for example, must have masks on and must maintain 6 feet distancing, that would apply to a political party, even though it's operating under the First Amendment. It would apply to people in a newspaper office, even though that's operating under the First Amendment. And it would apply also to a church, even though they're operating under the First Amendment. Now, last Friday, the Centers for Disease Control released guidance for faith communities advising places of worship to limit the use of choirs and tightly packed musical ensembles because the act of singing may contribute to transmission of COVID-19. The CDC, it also warned of super spreader events, whether secular or religious, where the virus is highly transmissible, including group singing events like the choir practice in the state of Washington, where one super spreader infected 52 other singers, including two who died within a few weeks. There was also an outbreak of 70 infections from a church in Washington, and an outbreak also in an Arkansas church that infected more than one third of the assembled congregation and killed three people. The day after the CDC published their guidelines, the White House forced their removal and replaced them with altered guidance that removed all mention of the high risks of transmission in group singing events and deleted other scientific evidence-based advice. Now, that's just dangerous. Mayor Garcetti, you've announced that houses of worship in LA may reopen as long as they follow neutral public health state guidelines. Can you describe what those guidelines are in California?
Absolutely. Thank you. And thanks for that opening. You know, this past weekend, I spoke at my synagogue virtually, gave commentary on the Torah portion for the first time in my life. My rabbi, Sharon Brous, invited me to be a part of this. We have a prayer circle every morning with my rabbis and a bunch of pastors, and we have a few members of the faith community come together to get us through this. And we know how important faith has been, but we also know how dangerous it has been. Mayor Scott, you so powerfully talked about what happened in your city, and our heart aches for that sort of death. And I know that you've talked about a pastor who came from Tulsa and traced back some of what might have happened there. We need to practice faith, we need to practice freedom, and we need to do it in a way that doesn't kill us. And so right now, 25% of capacity is allowed in the state of California, or 100 people, whichever is less. We've had counseling and the ability to go in and talk to your pastor, or your priest, your imam, your rabbi throughout. But this is a way to make sure. But I've got to say, most folks are not going back to church. They're not going back to synagogue. They're not going back to their temples or mosques because they understand that that's a danger. It was at funerals. It was at choir practice. And these places where we've seen super spreader events. So we've given that guidance. It's allowed. But I would say, you know, we have this myth that once we open it up, everybody's back there. Life isn't back to normal for folks.
Thank you, Mayor Garcetti. And I'm sorry for any insinuation that came from this panel that you are anything other than a great champion of the Constitution, as well as the public health of your people in Los Angeles. Mayor Bottoms, we've lost more than 100,000 Americans, and 38 million have been thrown out of the work during this pandemic crisis. There has been a rather helter-skelter, chaotic response with lots of states going in different directions. Do you think it's important to have a coordinated national guidance to promote safe reopening? Do you see dangers in a continued scattershot, chaotic, helter-skelter approach?
Yes, I do, Congressman. And the concern that I have is that as we face potentially a second wave from this pandemic, we are now continuing to recover and learn what the playbook is from the first wave. This is not a city facing a tornado or a flood or even a drought. There is no playbook for this. That's why it's important that we have a coordinated effort on behalf of our federal government to give us a framework for how we can and should proceed as cities across this country. What we know about COVID-19 is that it knows no geographical lines. It does not behoove any of us to close down our cities. It was not my wish to not be able to attend my son's high school graduation. This is not where we want to be as mayors or as Americans, but certainly we need a framework and we need guidance from the federal government. We are learning as we go. We are creating a playbook as we go. And my concern that in the event of a second wave, we will not have memorialized and learned the lessons from the first wave, and we will be in a worse off position than we are today.
Thank you, Mayor Bottoms. And Mr. Chairman, I just want to salute all of these local leader heroes, as well as the mayors in my district, from Sykesville to Middletown to Rockville to Kensington to Tacoma Park, for what they're doing to support the people on the front lines. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Raskin. Thank you, Ms. Bottoms. We now recognize Dr. Green.
Thank you, Chairman Clyburn and Ranking Member Scalise, and thanks to our witnesses today. I too want to send Tennessee and my family's prayers to the people of Minneapolis and the Floyd family. At our last hearing, I spoke about how changes in the science of medicine often lead to a complete reversal in what we do. I gave the example of treating pain with opiates and creating addiction. Since that testimony just a week ago, the New England Journal of Medicine has published an article that says wearing a mask outside the hospital setting offers little, if any, protection from infection. Let me quote that in context. Quote, "We know that wearing a mask outside healthcare facilities offers little, if any, protection from infection. Public health authorities define a significant exposure to COVID as face-to-face contact within 6 feet with a patient with symptomatic COVID that is sustained for at least a few minutes, maybe 10 minutes, maybe 30 minutes. The chance of catching COVID from a passing interaction in a public space is therefore minimal. In many cases, the desire for widespread masking is a reflexive reaction to anxiety over the pandemic," end quote. Again, that's the New England Journal of Medicine this week. Before I misquoted, I want to assure you I'm not taking a position on the mask issue. I just want to point out that as more research continues to be done on the coronavirus, the novel coronavirus, we have to be cautious to not make broad sweeping changes to public policy with ever-changing medical information. That's my contribution to this committee. And we must be cautious to criticize our leaders for decisions and statements made in real time based off the best available data at the time, like criticizing the president for statements in February based on medical information that we have today. That includes his comments about China. As a doctor, I can tell you the cost of waiting to reopen until a possible vaccine is going to cost lives, and that is well-established data. Consider the additional 33,000 cancer deaths that are going to happen due to delayed diagnosis just because the hospitals are closed. We've got to consider deaths from suicides that are expected to exceed 75,000 additional patients, or the thousands of heart attacks and strokes due to deaths because people are afraid to go to the ER. There seems to be a difference between how some states and cities are responding to the decision of opening up. It's clear we've flattened the curve. Not a single American has died because we didn't have a ventilator or because we didn't have an ICU bed. But some want to keep Americans at home until there's not a single new transmission of the virus. That decision to delay reopening will mean more deaths to cancer, heart attack, stroke, and suicide than if we opened up today. As a former state senator, I understand the federal government has a role. The president has a sensible plan with guidelines. It's just not the top-down, centralized approach that concentrates power in the hands of a few and that treads on the state sovereignty. It's a resource-based guideline approach that lets states make their own decisions and then live with the consequences, something our founders would be proud of. Further, this public health emergency should not be used as an excuse to bail out past reckless state and local government. Tennessee ranks in the top 10 states of the least state and local debt per capita. However, Illinois, California, and Washington rank in the top 10 for the most state and local debt per capita. Illinois hadn't balanced its budget since 2001. Tennessee, on the other hand, has been on sound financial footing for decades. Why should Tennesseans be forced to bail out Illinois' reckless spending? For instance, $23.6 million on programs that encourage people to ride their bikes, or $13.1 million on an arts council chaired by the wife of the Illinois House Speaker, Mike Madigan, or research on monarch butterflies, or programs to encourage young people to take up golf? I mean, why not fishing? I'm a fisherman. I guess it's just more government picking the winners and losers, and this time in recreation. Why should Tennessee be forced to bail out the city of Philadelphia, which made at least $924 million in bookkeeping errors in 2017 alone? If I bounce a check, it's not your job to pay my debt. And it's unfair and frankly immoral to ask you to do so. We need to reopen the economy and get Americans working again. This will help restore not only the budgets of our citizens, but the budgets of our state and local governments too. And as I started this conversation, it will save American lives. Mayor Curry, a quick question. What are the consequences for healthcare in your city if we don't open up soon?
The consequences are dire on so, but Representative, thanks for the question. The consequences are dire on so many fronts. As I said before, 100,000 deaths in the country, people died alone. Tragic, terrible that this virus came here, that we didn't have the facts from the World Health Organization and from China. But we've got to reopen this economy and focus on the vulnerable. And just to echo some of the things that you said, I agree that a top-down approach doesn't work. Every city, every municipality is different. I agree that we shouldn't be bailing. COVID-19 relief should not be used to bail out poor decision-making. In my city, we built up significant reserves over the last 4 years in the event we face a crisis. We reformed our pensions here in Duval County, secured a source of revenue, put new employees into defined contribution plans versus defined benefit plans. So relief from COVID-19 is needed, but it needs to be specific to the pandemic, not bailing out poor fiscal decisions.
If I could just state what I heard you say to our committee, you didn't spend money on monarch butterflies or encouraging kids to play golf. You put it in the bank for a crisis. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Green. The chair now recognizes Mr. Kim.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, for convening this. I wanted to start with a couple of questions to Mayor Garcetti and Mayor Barnett. Mayor Garcetti, at the end of your opening comments, you started to talk about the deadline that's coming up, as well as what would happen after that should you not be able to receive funding, or other states or cities not be able to receive that. I'd like to drill into that and just really try to get a sense of the urgency here and the timeline of your decision making. Tell us what happens at the end of next month. Tell us what happens if you don't get that funding, and what would happen to the city workers and the local workers there, and the other decisions that are on the table.
Absolutely. And again, I think we see this in such a nonpartisan and bipartisan way. I mean, we've got as many Republicans in Southern California as I think in many of the states that are so-called red states. We've got 10 million Republicans that are in California. Many of them work in city government. In the same way that PPP didn't just say, here's money, by the way, whether you ran your business well or not, and I'll get to that in a second, PPP didn't say, hey, here's money just for your expenses with COVID-19. It was, here's money to keep people employed. I think we really have to keep focused on that, because there will be layoffs, there will be shortfalls, and from very well-run cities like mine that also, and congratulations, Mayor Curry, great job in Jacksonville. We've done the same thing and had double our reserves of before 2008 when this crisis hit, and Wall Street, don't take my word for it, hasn't even downgraded us in the midst of this. But you've got places like Ohio where income tax is much more important. I've talked to mayors who are looking at laying off 20%. Phoenix in Arizona, where they've already started looking at the layoffs. This will come in the next couple of months, and I guarantee you it'll be the biggest bump in the unemployment numbers as we reopen. It'll more than wash over the progress that we do. So it is to keep employment and to deliver those key services we need to win this fight.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. Mayor Barnett, I wanted to turn to you. My district looks a lot closer to the size of your town than it is to Mayor Garcetti. So I want to get a sense of are you seeing that same thing? Are you having those same types of deadlines and that urgency? What would happen if you were not able to get these resources at the time that you need?
Thank you, Congressman, for the question. Yeah, the size of the city doesn't seem to come into play too often. The critical nature of this is still the same. I'm from a red city in a state that voted for the president. Our city has traditionally been very financially sound, but without any mismanagement, we're going to lose a third of our budget. And there are not too many places across America, Republican-run or democratically run, that could handle that without massive cuts. I've got parks employees on furloughs. I've got building department employees on furloughs. We've laid off folks. Those are real things that have impacted the service, because in local government, you can either raise taxes, cut services, or innovate. Well, it's impossible to raise taxes right now. Cutting services is what we're forced to do. And of course, we're thriving on a spirit of innovation, as most mayors are, to try to find new ways to do things better, a little more efficiently. The cuts are real. And it's not just in cities like mine or maybe like yours in your district. Every community in America, a study we did, the National League of Cities, looked at 2,400 communities across the country, 2,400, 98% of them. That is irrespective of party, geographic location, financial position. 98% of them said they're going to have massive budget shortfalls. So, Congressman, you're tuned into the fact that the time is now, and the message is critical.
That's great. Yeah, I agree with you wholeheartedly here. I think it's that timing, that urgency that I really want to get across to my colleagues in Congress and to other leadership, because we spend a lot of time talking about what you need, but it's also about when you need it. And when I look at this in my own district, we see what happened with the coronavirus to no fault of your own, all of you mayors have been trying to respond to this. You know, in my district, we experienced something similar a couple of years back where, to no fault of our own, due to Superstorm Sandy, we had a tremendous amount of problems that we had to recover from. Ranking Member Scalise, also from a state that understand what it's like to get hit by a natural disaster, to no fault of their own. And this isn't about budgeting and whether or not things are seen in the right way, whether or not these are right decisions. We are facing a disaster here that we're trying to recover from. My district is still trying to recover from that. And Mr. Barnett, I wanted to seek your thoughts since you engage with mayors all across the country. My towns and my district are continuing to struggle, having to pay off debts to the federal government from the Superstorm Sandy, and they're having to continue to do this through this crisis. Do you think that the federal government should be considering easing or canceling some of these debts to help these towns get through this current crisis?
Yeah. Well, again, it's a complicated question. I know for a fact that cities can't do this without federal partners. We're just not set up that way. And so that's why you see mayors from across the country on this panel pleading with you, all from different, you know, political backgrounds, but all really professing a love for their communities and a desire to see them succeed. We want to see them reopen. We want to see our business community reopen. I have a lot of ideas and suggestions about that. But we have to have the federal partnership. And as to date, it sounds like most of the cities in your district, probably none of them have received any federal support. Unless you're over 500,000 population, you haven't received federal support directly yet. So the idea that we have to work at this together, which is why coming from the Conference of Mayors, the idea that we have to approach this from a nonpartisan perspective, that all of us are Americans and desire to see our communities succeed, our small businesses succeed, and our communities stay healthy, is critically important. We're willing to put any idea on the table. I think, you know, there's some general concern, you know, in Heroes that the Heroes bill is too big. From a Republican side and the Democratic side of mayors may be concerned that the Republicans may put too many restrictions on it. Most mayors I talk to are absolutely willing to talk about some realistic guardrails in order to get the federal support we need. We really feel like we can be partners because we understand the need on the ground in the moment. And that's what we're here to try to express to you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kim, and thank you, Mr. Barnett. Before I close this briefing, I would like to yield now to Ranking Member Scalise for whatever closing statements he might make.
Thanks again, Mr. Chairman. And I really appreciate all the information that was shared here today and what input the mayors have given. Clearly, I think we all want to see our communities get back open, understanding safety, understanding the reality of the negative consequences. What we saw as communities got shut in through no fault of their own, but obviously the opening is going differently in different communities, and hopefully we will keep sharing the best practices. And I know each mayor has brought some different things to the table that show what can be done well, but I think we all ought to be looking at those things that have been successful so that communities can safely reopen. It's disappointing when you see media hysteria saying one thing, and then you'll see a town like Jacksonville reopen and the beaches, even though that's social distancing, they'll try to portray it as something other than what it is and, you know, try to act like there's going to be this mass outbreak of deaths. ABC News just did a study. I think it just came out today where they looked at 21 different states that aggressively reopened. I think they looked at those states that reopened March 4th or sooner. And I think initially the reports were that those communities would see big outbreaks, and they noticed that none of those states had a higher than expected increase in COVIDs. In fact, most have flattened. And so that study was really important to show that there is a way to safely reopen, and we have to get our economies back up and running. There is no substitute for getting businesses back up. I've heard from so many small businesses that appreciate the bipartisan work we just did yesterday on reforming the Paycheck Protection Program, giving more runway to our small businesses. That was a case where Chip Roy, our Republican member who worked very hard with Dean Phillips, came together, came up with an idea, worked with businesses, worked with the Department of Treasury, and came up with something that we as Republicans, working with a Democrat majority, were able to pass with over 400 votes, a massive showing that hopefully the Senate will take and move, and then get to the president who wants to sign that bill. So it shows you we can work together and have found ways to innovate and address some of these problems. And we need to keep doing that while we help get businesses reopened, because there are some businesses that even without all this relief, trillions of dollars we've already passed, still won't be able to reopen. And those jobs will be lost. Let's try to limit that. We limit the loss of life. We also limit the loss of jobs, and we limit the loss of life that's tied to the closing down of the economy. So, Mr. Chairman, again, I appreciate you giving us this forum. Hopefully, let's continue to share these best ideas and keep helping to safely reopen this country. And I yield back.
I thank the ranking member for his friendship. Thank him so much for his participation here today. I thank all members for their participation. And I want to thank the panelists for their remarks. We know how busy you are. You are on the front lines, leading your communities through a truly historic crisis. I think I speak for all of our members in saying that we are grateful for your leadership, your insights, and your tireless work on behalf of the people of your cities and this nation. What came through loud and clear from today's panel is that America's communities urgently need the federal government to exercise leadership in order to beat this virus. Now, COVID-19 has precipitated the closing of businesses, the suspension of educational pursuits, the dashing of hopes, the deferral of dreams. Several of our panelists and members opened their comments today offering prayers and condolences to George Floyd and the people of Minneapolis. As I listened to these comments and as I focused this morning and last night on what was occurring in Minneapolis, Minnesota, listened to the comments here today, I reflected upon this panel's work. And I found myself a bit incapable of expressing how I really felt. And then I thought about a poem that gave rise to a play in which I participated as a college student and asked the question, what happens to dreams deferred? What happens to a dream deferred? Langston Hughes wrote those words looking at the Harlem, the city of New York, when certain challenges like these were being experienced. And he wrote these words, what happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sow and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat or crust and sugar over like a syrup is sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load. Or does it explode? This briefing is now closed. Thank you.